Good morning. Welcome to Grace Bible Church Online. This week, an email came to me from History Facts, which I get regularly, but it's not facts. Listen to this. For the first billion years or so of the planet's existence, the surface was simply too hot for water to be anything but vapor. In fact, they say that the water wasn't always there on the Earth. Around 3.8 billion years ago, the temperature finally dropped below the water's boiling point of 212 degrees, and the vapor turned to rain, and it showered for centuries, filling the deepest parts on the planet's surface and building up moisture in the atmosphere. This was essential for life developing on Earth. The first single-cell microbes appeared in the ocean about 3.5 billion years ago. I wonder who was there to see that. Now, here it says, scientific opinion is mixed on how the vaporized water got there in the first place. One theory is that the water emerged from inside the Earth as part of a volcanic activity. Another is that icy comets hit the Earth, bringing water with them, or that water arrived as part of the massive planetary collision that created the moon, or maybe it was a combination. Now, listen to this. But today, our planet is in the perfect zone for water solids, liquids, and gases to form. A little closer to the sun, and we'd all be vapor. A little farther away, and we'd have no vapor at all. You know what I thought of that? If you would read 10 verses in Genesis chapter 1, it would solve the problem. We have a creator. God put the water on Earth, and the Earth is in the perfect zone. Not by chance, not by accident. We believe the word, and that's why we preach it as truth. Let's thank the Lord for that. Father in heaven, thank you so much that you are indeed the creator, and this nonsense that we read of false science is just exactly that. We thank you that your word is authoritative. I pray that you would bless Pastor Daniel today as he shares your word, and that it may have an impact in our lives because your word is truth. We're grateful for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall. Forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God.
which slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy.
My soul. Good morning, Church. I'd like to take our Persecuted Church segment this morning and go in a completely different direction than what we would normally talk about during these segments. I would like to speak with you about the persecution that goes on at universities and colleges in the U.S., particularly those of a secular nature. Now, if you live in the U.S., you probably already know all about the liberal, woke, anti-Christian, anti-Jewish culture and attitudes going on at a lot of the mainline colleges and universities in this country. If you are outside of the U.S., you may not. But I have a good friend of mine that works as a campus evangelist at the University of Colorado State in Fort Collins, Colorado. And I asked him to share with me recently some of the difficulties that they face as Christians on a secular campus and some of the persecutions they might endure. So if you would bear with me, I would like to read a letter word for word that he had sent me. So I'll have to look off screen for this. But it is very interesting. I myself went and attended a secular university, and I know all about the things that he speaks of in his letter. You may also, if you have also gone to a secular university. And sadly, some of these things even occur at what is supposed to be Christian colleges and universities. So let me go ahead and read this letter to you. For the past 22 years, we have served in the gospel ministry primarily at Colorado State University as campus evangelists. We work on staff for our local church, Grace Christian, which coincidentally is not affiliated, obviously, with Grace Bible in Adel. Our vision and mission is to evangelize college students during a crucial time in their lives and believe for them to get saved, discipled, and planted in the local church as the Lord leads. We accomplish this primarily through outdoor evangelism as we approach 30,000 students per year on average with the gospel message to identify those who would like to learn more. From there, we establish hundreds of weekly Bible studies to bring the Word of God into the students' lives on a consistent basis. This school year, we saw 89 students pray to surrender their lives to Jesus and be saved. Now, quickly, before I continue, the student population of Colorado State University is approximately 33,000 students. So 89 salvations might not sound like a lot, but those 89 students can go back to their families, their friends. Spiritual multiplication can occur. And of course, even one lost soul is important to the Lord. And I believe, if I'm not mistaken, 89 is the highest number they have ever seen during a school year. So they are really making progress. And this is just a great positive note. So to continue, you can imagine the challenges and persecution we face as we approach so many with the truth of sin, righteousness, and future judgment. We believe and preach that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and that no one comes to the Father apart from Him. We preach that heaven and hell are real places that Jesus described in great detail. Paul said in Romans chapter 1 that he is not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. People were trying to shame him and say that he was the problem, when in all reality, he was bringing the eternal solution. We are persecuted much the same way. From the secular university to the college newspaper, we are labeled as a problem. Rumors inaccurately spread that all we do is tell students that they are going to hell. that we are carelessly recruiting to build our group. Some even say that we are a cult. We are shamed that we are too inclusive and that not everyone is welcome. We are shamed that we don't care about those bound to the works of darkness described in Romans chapter 1. Articles are written to stir up fear and mistrust about us, but the gates of hell will not prevail against the church. The woke agenda cannot stand us because we speak the truth in love. We say what is needed as opposed to what is wanted, because that is what true love does. Many upperclassmen will go as far as interrupting our evangelistic conversations. It can get pretty unethical, even comical at times. We are also persecuted because we take a strong stand against the idolatry of immorality that is so prevalent on the college campuses today. Repentance leads to freedom, but that is not a popular message today. And as I've said, these things that Ryan talks about, I have personally experienced on a secular college campus. To continue, the students that receive Jesus have a spiritual battleground they face as well. Living in the residence halls on campus can be a real fight of faith for those desiring to walk free from sin. From the worldly video games into the wee hours of the morning, to the drug and alcohol parties that are everywhere, young believers have to stand firm on the campus. The temptation into sexual immorality is readily available and stronger than ever. I have learned over the years that the greatest way to help the next generation is to equip them with exactly what the Bible says about the many social temptations they will face. The power of the Holy Spirit is available to be victorious. To equip them that the Bible says you will be persecuted, that's a promise and a blessing. The world is supposed to be surprised that you do not run with them into the same excesses of dissipation, and they will malign you. That is from 1 Peter chapter 4. The secular newspaper is supposed to persecute and not understand the things of the kingdom. We have learned to become thankful for the persecution that we face, which in the grand scope of the globe is pretty minimal. To suffer the reproach of Christ is a privilege and an honor. Thank you to all who pray for the persecuted church. Now again, this is a really non-standard persecuted church segment, but I do hope that you get an idea of what new Christian students face on these types of campuses. I have many times alluded to college campuses as the devil's playground, and maybe, sadly, even high school campuses now as well. There are many, many forms of sin, idolatry, temptation, the drug culture, immoral lifestyles that just pervade society today, and not just in the U.S., but everywhere. But let's pray that the evangelists and the students that have made recent professions of faith in Christ would stand firm in their newfound faith. Heavenly Father, we just thank you and praise you that despite the obstacles that these evangelists face on many, maybe even most, secular college campuses in this country, that you continue to protect them, to guide them, and to help them find those students who are seeking something. They may not know it's you, but I thank you for their presence on these campuses, and I pray for these students, these young men and women, Lord, who come to faith in you, but have just a great deal of persecution and difficulties from the world and from the society and the culture that they currently live in. We know it is very strong at that level. We pray that you would help them to stand firm in their faith, that they would trust your word, and Lord, that they would grow in their newfound faith. Thank you for this ministry of Grace Christian Church in Colorado. We pray that you would help it to continue to thrive and be successful. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, church. Have a good day today.
I remember when a long lost sinner met a good, good God. I remember when my heart was broken, but now it's not. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. From the moment that you changed my life, God, you never stopped. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout it, I'm gonna lift my hands and praise. No matter what is gonna come my way, all you've done for me, I give you the glory. From the valley to the victory, I know my God is gonna fight for me. So when the devil come try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. When the devil come try to get me, gonna praise the Lord. From the moment when the sun starts rising till the sun goes down, I'm surrounded by a million mercies. I can feel them now. I've tasted and I've seen, you've been so good to me. Got a melody inside my heart, oh, here's a sweet, sweet sound. I'm gonna sing it, I'm gonna shout.
Don't hold it against me, but I grew up listening to country music. I know some people do not like that, but there's something yet today about a little bit of twang and a note bent on a steel guitar that still tickles my heart yet today. I'm not much in favor of the new stuff. It's more so just pop and rap that's played to a country music style anymore. And I didn't really get into the old Conway Twitty and George Jones kind of music. I grew up with George Strait and Alan Jackson and Reba McEntire, some of the great people that were pivotal in that 80s and 90s era. Perhaps what I liked most, though, about the music as a genre was the genuineness of feelings being expressed through music. Now, I'm not endorsing it necessarily as a music genre, but you know, and like others, it has its flaws. It's what I grew up with in a rural farming community, and it's what I still like listening to occasionally yet today. And I've heard all the jokes about country songs, specifically the one of what do you get when you play it backwards,
You get your wife back, your house back, your dog back, your truck back, all that other kind of stuff. Anyway, as with any musical genre, there are some songs, though, that just annoy us and rub us the wrong way. I'm sure you could probably name a few that come to mind, and there's even perhaps a few within Christian music as well. They just don't fit your taste or your personality or perhaps your preferences. And it was in October of 2011, what I like to call the Wisconsin theme song was released on country music radio. It was a drinking song by Toby Keith called Red Solo Cup. And once you hear it, the lyrics seem to almost burn into your brain. And I don't like alcohol, but that wasn't even really the main issue with the song. From the first time I heard it, it was just this grating, I don't know, it grated on me, on my personality and brain and mind and whatever. And interestingly, about 10 years prior to that, in 2001, another song was released by the same man, Toby Keith, and had that same kind of grating effect on my ears. And it's just one of those, it's hard to get out of your brain when it's in there. And the song was entitled, I Want to Talk About Me. And it portrays a man who is fed up with his significant other, always having the conversation center on herself, and he just wants to talk about himself. And if there's any sort of redeeming quality in the song, about it's about having perhaps a balance in conversation and relationship, but whenever I see and hear the lyrics, there's only really one word that ever truly comes to mind, and that's self-centeredness. And we are no strangers to the impact that a me-centered focus has had on our world. It has been a pervasive problem, not just in our time, but throughout the history of our world. In fact, it's the original sin, you might say. And in preparing this series, I was talking with a local counselor who had mentioned that one of the major issues he deals with in counseling is what he calls selfish individualism. Now, if you hear that term, it sounds like a no-brainer, or that I'm repeating myself. And, you know, don't those words really mean the same thing? And, well, duh, we all know that selfishness is a problem. And I had similar thoughts until the counselor explained further what that term meant. While selfishness has been a problem for ages, individualism, I think, is something that's really been encouraged, particularly within recent decades. That idea of you being you, of standing out from the crowd and not letting others reshape or redefine you in any way, or being independent and self-reliant. You don't need anybody. Now, you put that into the context of two married people, newly married people as he did, and it looks something like this. You have two individuals who are married and living under the same roof, sharing the same residence, but continuing to maintain their former identities, their former friends, their former hobbies, with no cohesion at all. They coexist, sharing the same last name and mailing address, but they continue to live their lives as they did before their partner came into their life. And you don't have to let your imagination explore that for very long, and you begin to picture the problems that will and can arise and understand where that relationship ultimately leads. And that conversation got me to thinking, as he spoke about selfish individualism in the context of that young married couple, the Lord began to run through my mind all the other areas that this kind of ideology, whether we call it that or not, affects, and biblically how we can respond to that. And so this morning, let's take a moment to see how pervasive, how complete this problem is across the various realms of relationship, and then focus on three biblical prescriptions or remedies to address the matter. And I pray that as we do, first of all, that you'll be open to the Spirit's work of leading and of conviction in your life, and where we may need to grow personally. We are all too quick to perceive what is going on in someone else's life and say, boy, you know, they could really listen to this and it would really help them, before first and foremost applying it to ourselves. And so I want us to do that first. But I also pray that you will be open to the truth of the Word and understand these key truths that you can use in discipling people around you toward healthier, hopefully healthier, relationships. Let's start, though, with where selfish individualism has invaded relationships. As with many things, when we approach the subject of individualism, or we need to approach it, with a balance and a commitment to understand what the other person is communicating as they use that term. Paul and I have found all too often, many times, that arguments ensue because people think that they're working with the same definitions and understandings of a concept when in fact they're not. And biblically, as we look at this subject, the Bible speaks of the individual having value because they have been created in the image of God, because they are dearly loved by Him, because they have been given various abilities and personalities, things that they are meant to steward well, for not only for the good of their own lives, but for the good of others and ultimately for His glory. The Bible, in fact, commends the individual who takes the stand morally and righteously, often in contrast to the moral filth around them. But the Bible condemns individualism when, as a concept, it takes an inward focus and one person's needs outweigh everyone else's, that the world should revolve around them and that their thoughts and ideas, etc., are the epicenter of concern above all others. And if this is as big of an issue as we're saying it is, any good diagnostician looks over all the tests, considers all the signs and symptoms, and examines all the areas of concern before forming a diagnosis and then recommending a prescription. So let's do that now. Where do we see selfish individualism in our culture? We're going to start with marriage, and I touched on this briefly already, but my counselor friend mentioned again, he's seeing it most in young marriages. As two young people enter into a marriage, he has found repeatedly that they want to be married but want to continue to live their lives as if they were still single yet. And these two that are supposed to become one flesh per Genesis chapter 2 actually are not. They may share, again, the same residence, they may share the same last name, they may possess a piece of paper that says they're married, but they continue essentially to live separate lives. And their friendship circles don't meld, their hobbies and pastimes don't cross paths, they coexist together but do not merge into the unity that God calls them to. And before those of you who may be older watching start condemning young people on this, it's just as much of an older person problem as well. I was listening to a clip from Dave Ramsey the other day, and the caller asked him, he said, when people get married, what do they do with their finances? Do they suddenly combine everything? And he simply answered, well, yes, they do. To which the caller replied, and split everything down the middle. I appreciate his next remark. He says, no, you combine everything. There is no middle. He said, he continued, and I appreciate this remark. The preacher didn't say, and now you're a joint venture. He said, and now you're one. And he continued to address that mindset the caller was using of my money and his and her money, or my car and his and her car, etc. He says, you need to switch your pronouns from my, his, her, and your to we and our. Now, and I know there's, and I realize there's a difference of opinion on separate incomes and how budgets are handled, but I want us to note the mindset of the caller. Selfish individualism segregates the marriage relationship into his and her quadrants and prevents a union unilaterally across every area of that relationship. That's not to say that married people won't have times alone separately, or that they might not enjoy certain things by themselves. But when two people allow their needs and wants and identity to take hierarchy in the relationship over the other, they naturally create division and prevent the marriage from becoming what God intended it to be. In Genesis chapter 1, verses 26 to 27, God said that He made man in His image. And I think part of that, I believe, was fellowship. And you look at the Godhead, Father, Son, Spirit, they have had this close-knit fellowship for eternity and share equally in activity. All three create, all three were a part of our salvation, all three were involved in the resurrection of Christ. And that concept of both unity and fellowship is meant to be a part of that marriage relationship, but is suffocated by selfish individualism. Beyond the marriage, we don't have to look much further, simply to the family. If you just take what we've already talked about for the marriage and move that into the family, because remember, children adopt what they see being lived out by their parents and grandparents, what chaos does this bring to the family? You know, as a parent, if I were to live solely for myself and maintain all of my identity prior to having a family, I may not have any concern for my wife or my children. If I do not love my wife as Christ loves the church, what example will my children have of the love God has for us? If I don't set biblical boundaries in my home and have then little to no discipline when boundaries are crossed, what do I teach my children about, first of all, the holy standards God has for our lives, and also the judgment and discipline that comes when we act in unrighteousness before Him? And I could run down a number of other avenues in this, but I'll simply say that selfish individualism creates parents and an environment where the character of God and His truth are not taught, nor are they modeled, and thus the byproduct of that, apart from God's marvelous intervention through His grace and mercy, is another generation continuing in that same pattern and likely to a greater degree than their parents. You have individuals sharing the same home, perhaps eating at the same table, but again, there's no cohesion or true relationships. We could move that mentality then into the church and discuss it from that angle. There, you essentially have someone then who's joined a club. You know, they pay their dues for the membership. Of course, offering doesn't buy you membership here. I want to make that clear. But that's, you know, I come, I give my money, and then I walk back out the door. I don't contribute my grace gifts, my talents and abilities, my prayers, my discipleship, the perspective I bring to the Word during conversations and discussions. And really on Sunday morning, those suffering from this selfish individualism are solely concerned with what they might get from the time spent with the body rather than prayerfully approaching that time or any corporate gathering for that matter with the focus of how the Lord will use them to minister to someone. I might go so far as to say that with selfish individualism, church becomes something I do rather than who I am. And I hurry up to get it checked off the list for the week so that I can focus on the things that I truly want to do, or I skip out on the corporate gatherings altogether because there's something more important I feel on my agenda. In fact, the Lone Ranger Christian might be the byproduct of this mentality in some respects, you know, that I don't need anybody else. I appreciate this remark from an article I had read. It says, you can't grow without change. Change usually comes from pressure. God uses others to pressure us. Iron sharpens iron. You know, I was convicted many years ago that the people in the church that I may not always have the deepest relationships with that may even rub me the wrong ways from time to time. We just admit it, there are those individuals in our local churches. But those may be the individuals that God uses the most in our lives to shape us further into the image of Christ. As I one perhaps learn patience and compassion with them beyond my comfort zones of showing those things, as I adopt the mind of Christ to understand further who they are and begin to appreciate them for who God created them to be. Our marriages, our family, our churches, also our relationship with God is where this is affected as well. In my last sermon, I had mentioned it, and I already mentioned it this morning, that returning to those foundational chapters of Genesis is so important. And if we skip those first 9 to 11 chapters in Genesis in particular, we miss so many answers about why we are in the mess we're in, about what we're created for, and really the foundational information about who God is and His plan. And I never thought of it in this light, but Genesis chapter 3 actually combats selfish individualism as it shows us really that it was at the heart of the plot of the fall. The devil had already tried to usurp God per Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28. Now he tries and ultimately succeeds in corrupting mankind. But I want to make clear that as I say that, mankind is still held responsible for his decision. It was his decision to disobey that command that God had given, not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Where is selfish individualism then within the story of the fall? And during my studies this week, I was watching a clip by Paul Tripp, and I'd like to share just a few words from that to you, which I think, clarify the situation and expound really on the ramifications of that fateful decision to eat of the fruit. And he remarks, he says, individualism is the result of the fall. What are Adam and Eve saying? As they ate of that fruit, they are essentially saying, we don't need you. We can live without you. We can live without your power, without your presence, without your grace, without your wisdom. We don't need it. The hook was individualized wisdom, wisdom that doesn't need community with God. And yet, all we have to do is start reading from Genesis chapter 1 through Revelation 22. And what does that show us? The entirety of the Bible shows us that we are created beings and that we desperately need God. Not only for our salvation, but even for the very breath of this moment. The Apostle Paul says in Colossians chapter 1, as he beautifully speaks about the supremacy of Christ, I love these words that he says, verses 16 to 17, for all things in heaven and on earth were created by him, that is Jesus. All things, whether visible or invisible, whether thrones or dominions, whether principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things are held together. And I think that verse beautifully transitions us into this next point of focus this morning. Now that we have seen the pervasiveness, the completeness of this problem, and how that is affecting the various realms of our lives, let's begin to explore the remedies. We start with, I think, the most important one of all. Remedy number one is trust in Jesus as your Savior. Trust in Jesus as your Savior. Back in 2008, I mentioned this just recently, when my grandma Wersima was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, we knew almost immediately that it was a fatal diagnosis. Pancreatic cancer in and of itself is nasty, and in part because it's asymptomatic in its early stages. And even as it progresses, its symptoms are easily missed usually, or they're diagnosed as something else. And I remember she had agreed to have surgery, kind of as one of those last ditch efforts to address the problem, potentially provide a solution. I think it really only ended up making her more weak and succumbing to her illness faster, I believe. As I was considering remedy number one, though, this week, the Lord was using this to give me a mental picture. Just like my grandma had received that fatal diagnosis, Scripture really has given us all a fatal diagnosis, which is sin. Sin is both a transgression, a disobedience of a God's law, a breaking of it, and a rebellion against God himself. And the consequence of that sin is death, that is eternal separation from God. Genesis shows us that we are meant to live in eternal fellowship with God, but when Adam and Eve usurped the command of God, it brought devastation upon humanity. And through the centuries, we have been trying to do surgery, if you will, to remedy the situation ourselves. We've cleverly disguised it even with religious names as a means to remedy the problem on our own. You know, but we read in Isaiah 64:6 that even our best is still considered utter filth, or utterly worthless, utterly incapable. We can't do soul surgery on ourselves. We aren't even qualified as spiritual surgeons, you might say. Only God is. And the beauty of Scripture is that as it unfolds before our eyes, God's plan of redemption. It shows us how utterly lost, how helpless we are apart from God. But then it also shows us, alongside that, the amazing plan of God to provide a solution for our spiritual cancer through His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, who paid the penalty for our sin, and provided the avenue for redemption and avenue of hope. And so if we want to remedy the sin problem in our lives, if we want to remedy selfish individualism, it starts first and foremost with placing our faith in Jesus Christ as our Savior. It's only through salvation that He provides, that we find the release from these chains and these bonds that so control our lives. We cannot escape this devastating and destructive path apart from salvation. The Apostle Paul writes in Romans chapter 7, verses 24 and 25, that it is through Jesus Christ that we find the deliverance we need from both sin and death, and the destruction that following this path brings to our families and marriages and communities and churches. And if you're ready this morning, I'd encourage you to make that decision of faith today. I'd encourage you to reach out to myself or to Pastor Paul. You can text us using WhatsApp and our landline number here at the church. You can message us on Facebook or type something in the comments on YouTube. You can reach out to us. We'd love to help answer any questions that you might have. We'd love to even just simply encourage you if you've made that decision of faith. You know, there's no special hoops to jump through. It's simply a recognition of your sin, your helplessness, the future that you face apart from Christ, and then turning to Him in faith, trusting in Him and His work alone to provide the redemption and rescue that you desperately need. Moving beyond, though, that initial belief in the gospel and our salvation through faith in Christ, as believers, we start this road called sanctification, where God is progressively conforming us into the image of Christ, per Romans chapter 8, verse 29. For us to advance in our spiritual growth, however, and to overcome the spiritual individualism that we are prone to, remedy number two, Jesus must be Lord of our lives. Now, from the get-go here, I want to be clear that this is not a condition for salvation. John makes it quite clear throughout his gospel that it is belief in Jesus Christ as our Savior that results in our salvation. The Apostle Paul echoes those same sentiments in Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, that our salvation is by grace through faith in Jesus Christ. And so I'm not preaching lordship salvation at all, but it is also clear from Scripture that while Jesus is our Savior as saved people, He is also our Lord, and that is a process of daily growth and application of how that concept of Him being master of our lives plays out in our day-to-day thoughts and words and actions. During the Feast of Weeks, or Shavuot, or known to some of us as Pentecost, Peter was preaching in Jerusalem to those who had gathered for this prescribed pilgrimage of the Jewish people in Leviticus 23. And at the conclusion of his speech, he states these very important words in Acts chapter 2, verse 36. He says, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know beyond a doubt that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." I want to hear that again. Both Lord and Christ. He's not only the long-promised Messiah or Mashiach, promised long ago throughout the Old Testament, He is also Lord. In fact, Jesus referred to Himself as Lord. And that term carries with it the ideas of authority and control and power over others. With Jesus specifically, there's an association of His deity with that term, that He is God. And this reality, Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, will be acknowledged not just by believers, but by all people one day, as every knee bows before Him. But I want us to come back to the significance here, the fact that He is Lord. In Jude verse 4, we read, "For certain men have secretly slipped in among you, men who long ago were marked out for the condemnation I am about to describe. Ungodly men who have turned the grace of our God into a license for evil and who deny our only master and Lord, Jesus Christ." 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, "But false prophets arose among the people, just as there will be false teachers among you. These teachers will infiltrate your midst with destructive heresies, even to the point of denying the master." The word is not kurios, which is normally for Lord. It is master there, but it is one who possesses supreme authority, denying the master who bought them. As a result, he will bring swift destruction on themselves. Note from those passages again, Jesus is not just our Savior, He's also our Lord. You know, and it's great that we praise Him as our Savior. It's great that we sing songs about the redemption that we find in Christ. It's great that we talk about the blood of Christ as the only means of our salvation, but we must not forget that He's also our Lord. Jesus didn't save us so that we can continue to live our lives however we want. Jesus didn't save us to give us a get-out-of-jail-free card. He didn't save us so that we could live for and focus solely on ourselves. He's not just our Savior, but also our Lord. And as your Lord, He has authority over your life. It is not your own. Not only was He that before salvation, but I'm convicted even more of this great truth and reality by the Apostle Paul's words in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 20, "For you were bought at a price. Therefore, glorify God with your body." So I am not my own. And because He is my Lord, my will doesn't matter anymore. My will is no longer the supreme element to rule my life. His will is my greatest concern. And I know there's a number of comments, this wasn't in my notes, but people have thought, well, if my will isn't considered, well, that's just going to be miserable. We don't push ourselves to think beyond that the Lord's will for us might actually be more desirable, more pleasurable, more fulfilling than what we have willed for ourselves. His will is what we are to explore, what we are to live. It's to consume our every thought and word and deed. One author writes, "An acknowledgement of Jesus' lordship is logically accompanied by a submission to Jesus' authority. If Jesus is Lord, then He owns us, and He has the right to tell us what to do." And now I know that's not going to be an immediate switch in our lives. I know that daily, as we surrender to the Spirit's work in our lives, and as we understand God more, you know, we surrender more of our lives to Jesus. And that's kind of it seems almost a day-by-day, minute-by-minute, bit-by-bit process sometimes. Concerning this matter, though, of selfish individualism, I believe that you and I will only make real progress as we surrender our wills and desires and plans and motives to Him and adopt His will as our own. The devil wants to make us believe that will be the most miserable place in life that we could possibly be. But the reality, and as oxymoronic as it sounds may sound to us, the place where we find the most depth and the most intimacy of our relationships, the place where we find the greatest joy and fulfillment, is not in following our will, but in being surrendered to His, to Jesus as Lord of our lives. And I think the evidence of whether Jesus is Lord in our life is seen ultimately in our obedience. In fact, Jesus Himself comments on this in Luke chapter 6. He says in verses 46 to 49, "Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not do what I tell you?" He says, "Everyone who comes to me and listens to my words and puts them into practice, I will show you what he is like. He's like a man building a house who dug down deep and laid the foundation on bedrock. When a flood came, the river burst against that house, but it could not shake because it had been well built. But the person who hears and does not put my words into practice is like a man who built a house on the ground without a foundation. And the river burst against that house, and it collapsed immediately and was utterly destroyed." Now, the passage concludes with an illustration of discipleship, but I believe it applies to Jesus as Lord in our lives as well. You know, and we're facing with this question, what do we need to surrender to Him? Where do we need to surrender? And whether we allow Jesus to be Lord in our lives really boils down to that question of what kind of foundation do you want in your life? Those surrendered to Christ and following Him in obedience can expect, I believe, a measure of stability in their lives. And those who do not can expect to find ruin in various forms. There's so much more, I believe, gained as Jesus is not only our Savior, but also as we live in light of the reality that He is our Lord as well. So count the cost of that. Count the benefit of continuing to live this life and my will and my desires versus following after Him. The last remedy, I believe, that helps in this plague of selfish individualism is to follow in the footsteps of Christ. So remedy number three, Jesus' example must be imitated. Must be imitated. I'd forgotten to bring it with me, but it's a little yellow box Several years ago, my EMS unit purchased carbon monoxide monitors for our membership. It's just a little yellow box we put in our vests to be kind of semi-protect us on certain calls. We periodically get calls for people who are experiencing nausea and feeling lightheaded with no other really signs or symptoms. You're not running a fever or anything else. In the winter, our first thought is that, well, it might be carbon monoxide poisoning. And because it's an odorless gas, first responders can quickly become a victim as well, hence the reason we wear those monitors on us. In a room, just to kind of give you a breakdown of this, carbon monoxide begins to disperse throughout the room equally. And as levels rise, we face greater and greater danger. Entering into the room, you breathe it in unknowingly, and as it enters our bodies, it attaches itself to our red blood cells, and it doesn't allow the vital oxygen molecules that we need to tag a ride on those red blood cells and then travel throughout our bodies. And so essentially what it ends up doing is it attaches itself to those red blood cells and then starves our bodies of the oxygen it desperately needs. One of the remedies is simply to move people to the outside where there's fresh air, to give them medical grade oxygen. There's some pressure therapies and things that they can do. In severe cases, sometimes patients have to be moved to a hyperbaric chamber to actually receive oxygen therapy. And if you don't know what that is, it's a man-made atmosphere where the air pressure is actually higher than what we're normally used to. And oxygen is essentially forced into your lungs, and that helps to eliminate then the carbon monoxide that has taken up residence there. Now, as strange as that illustration may sound in correlation to imitating Christ, here's the point I'd like to make and direct your attention to. When we're filling our minds with the things of the world and letting go of the reins of our hearts to chase after whatever it wants that's worldly, we are giving evil, we are giving the devil in many respects free rein in our lives to take up residence however they want. That, of course, has some serious spiritual side effects. Dealing with selfish individualism, we end up falling into the delusion that we are the source of our own life, that we must be the primary concern, that our desires must be fulfilled for there to be any sort of happiness or pleasure. And we can end up becoming resistant to any sort of authority, and we can end up experiencing loneliness because really nobody wants to be around that kind of person. As we continue in that environment, indulging ourselves and feeding on the world, we will continue to experience greater and greater spiritual side effects and ultimately devastation in our lives. Like the hyperbaric chamber, though, like that helps cure cases of carbon monoxide poisoning by filling the body with life-giving oxygen, our spiritual cure, our remedy, is to fill our lives with Christ. So much so that there's no more room for the things of this world, its ideologies, its passions, etc., to take up residence in our lives. John Piper appropriately wrote, he says, "Our soul is the jar, selfishness is the toxic fumes, and Christ is the water that pushes it out." Specifically, Christ's experience and our knowledge of Christ and our love of Christ, for Christ, and our trust in Christ. The experienced Christ, present, reigning, ruling, taking up residence in our lives, fully in fellowship, pushes it out. In other words, the best way to fight selfishness is not to think about selfishness, but to think about Christ, and specifically to think about what a great Savior He is, what a great Counselor He is, what a great Friend, a great Lord, Sustainer, and Champion, etc. I think we could boil all of this down to really one word: abiding. John writes in his first epistle that abiding in Christ, abiding in Christ is associated, I read that sentence wrong. John writes in his first epistle that abiding in Christ and He in us is associated not only with knowing Christ, but also obedience to Christ. It is walking as He has walked. And so then follow with me for just a moment here. As I surrender to the transforming work of the Spirit of God in my life, Romans 12:2. As I desire I should then desire to follow more after Christ, to follow Him, and what I must know Him through the Word, by the Spirit, through the encouragement of my fellow believers. As I understand Him and His ways further, and through the Spirit's wisdom in applying that to my life, I can more fully live in a manner that reflects Him. And as I continue that cycle of abiding, of knowing, of transforming, surrendering, and also, I think most importantly, imitating, I am filling my life with Christ and living as Christ, so much so that selfishness is being pushed out of my life and not given any more room to reside. Now, I'm not doing this in my own strength, in my own power. I want to make that clear. It's by the grace of God and His work in my life that allows this. But this is the remedy. The Apostle Paul's words to the church at Philippi always convict me. Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 through 5, he says, "Instead of being motivated by selfish ambition or vanity, each of you should in humility move to treat one another as more important than yourself. Each of you should be concerned not only about your own interests, but about the interests of others as well." And so he's not disregarding that we have valuable needs and concerns and things of that nature, but we're not focused solely on ourselves. We're focused on others as well. And you should have the same attitude toward one another that Jesus Christ had. To remedy selfish individualism that may be ingrained in our lives, Paul essentially commands us to adopt the mind of Christ. He commands us to walk in the footsteps of Christ, commands us to understand Jesus' example of humility and utter concern for others through the cross of Calvary, and apply that same attitude to our relationships. I think we can admit that we clearly see in our world the devastation that selfish individualism is bringing to relationships and to our society across the board. I'm not saying that everyone suffers from it to the same degree, but it is a problem, isn't it? And the remedy isn't more psychological ideologies. The remedy isn't other religions. The remedy isn't anything this world presents us. The remedy is not more of me. It's more of Christ. First of all, coming to know Him as your Savior through faith in Him and His finished work on the cross. Second, in allowing Him to be Lord. That is, surrendering every area of your life to Him, adopting His will as your will, and His desires as your desires, His plan as your plan. And third, by being so consumed with knowing Him and imitating Him that we essentially suffocate selfish individualism from our lives to greater degrees because He fills our lives and we're walking in His ways. Now, I'm not saying this is going to be easy. I'm not saying that you're still not going to be tempted along the way. But I am saying that I am confident that as we put these steps into action, that there will be a depth and a stability to those relationships that I talked about earlier that we may not have yet experienced. We will find the value of others. We will find a better joy than this world offers as we focus on Christ and not on ourselves. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for these challenges from Your word. And I pray first and foremost this morning that if there are any who have not professed faith in You for salvation, that today would be that day. That they would understand that for all the solutions this world offers, it's always essentially sugar water. It doesn't cure the real problem. It's a placebo. I pray that they would understand that the only true remedy can be found in Christ. That even as believers, that we would be confident in that. That, you know, we're comfortable with salvation, but moving on further to adopting and believing really that Jesus as Lord, as I am surrendered to Him, as I am imitating Him in my life, that is where I can find peace and stability in my relations. That's where I can find the depth that I'm longing for, as I'm focused on Him and living for Him. And I pray that as people adopt that kind of mindset, that they would find the value there. They would find the joy and fulfillment and happiness that brings. Living as we were always meant to live, as You prescribe. Give us the strength. Surround us with brothers and sisters in Christ who can encourage us to these ends. May Your Spirit guide us and give us wisdom in the application of these things. We pray this in Your name. Amen.
O great God of highest heaven, occupy my lowly heart. Own it all and reign supreme. Conquer every rebel power. Let no vice or sin remain that resists your holy war. You have loved and purchased me. Make me yours forevermore. I was blinded by my sin, had no ears to hear your voice, did not know your love within, had no taste for heaven's joys. Then your Spirit gave me life, opened up your word to me. Through the gospel of your Son, gave me endless hope and peace. Yes, you did. Me now to live a life that's dependent on your grace. Keep my heart and guard my soul from the evils that I face. You are worthy to be praised with my every thought and deed. Oh great God of highest heaven, glorify your name through me. You are worthy to be praised with my every thought and deed. O great God of highest heaven, glorify your name through me.
Well, isn't it good to have the Word of God to give us the direction that we need for life today? And we would certainly be marked as very different than the unbelievers in the world if we lived that way. Peter wrote, "You already know these things, dear friends," and of course you know them today because Pastor Daniel preached on them. "So be on guard then, you will not be carried away by the errors of these wicked people and lose your own secure footing." You know, there is a lot of pressure from the outside to live differently. But Peter writes, "Rather, you must grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. All glory to him, both now and forever." And God's people said, amen.